Welcome to CAUSES, the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. My name is Sabina O'Hara, and I'm the director of the university's PhD program in Urban Leadership and Entrepreneurship. And I welcome you to our occasional lecture series. Our speaker today is Professor Dr. Matthew Kahn, who is the Bloomberg Distinguished Professor of Economics and Business at Johns Hopkins University, where he also serves as the director of the 21st Century Cities Initiative. So Professor Kahn's research focus on urban economics, regional economics, and environmental economics is a perfect fit with our program and our urban-serving university. Professor Kahn has taught at Tufts University, Columbia University, UCLA, has been a visiting professor at Harvard and Stanford and the National University of Singapore. So he has a very distinguished record. He has also numerous books and articles that are of interest, particularly for an urban-focused programs like ours. One of his books is entitled Green Cities, Urban Growth and the Environment. Another one with a very interesting title is Climatopolis, that he also co-authored Blue Skies Over Beijing, Economic Growth and the Environment in China. But his focus today is on his newest book, namely Unlocking the Economic Potential of Post-Industrial Cities. Let's hear what Professor Kahn has to share with us.
So for example, in the case of Baltimore, even President Obama did not transfer huge amounts of money to the city of Baltimore. The governor of Maryland, Larry Hogan, is unlikely to make large transfers to the city of Baltimore. I do think that President Biden and Vice President Harris will take the Center City initiative more seriously than President Trump. But I do not believe that the federal government is going to make enormous investments in the cities. And Mac and I argued that this is one of the reasons it's so important for cities to figure out their solutions for how they're going to unlock their full potential. As I mentioned a moment ago, I'm going to start with the bad news, and then I'm going to try to get as quick as I can to the good news of some of the green shoots opening up for these cities. And this is an especially important time with the rise of work from home. With the rise of immigration post-Trump administration, there's new opportunities for these cities that have lost population to do a better job competing for jobs and people to stabilize their economies. And Mac and I believe that unlike cities like Manhattan, our six cities with their lower population density, a little bit like Goldilocks, they're dense enough to be exciting places, but they're not so dense to have the same contagion fears as a New York City, that there may be new opportunities in the post-COVID economy fueling these cities to make a comeback. So folks, I'm going to start with the bad news. And when you get a copy of my book, this is chapter two of the book. For all of our cities, relative to the United States, they've been losing population over the last 50 years. So you see here that St. Louis had the largest percentage reduction in population. So a fact is that Baltimore had 900,000 people in 1960 or so, and now it has 600,000 people. So that's a 33% reduction in population. People are voting with their feet to move to the suburbs or to move to other cities. So all six of our cities have shrunk in population, and that's ugly at a time when the rest of the US was growing. And that's what you see by that blue line up top. There's an old chicken and egg issue in urban economics. Do jobs follow people or do people follow jobs? Folks, here we're graphing the reduction in manufacturing jobs. And while every city has its own story, I hope that all of you can see that for all six of our cities, Baltimore, Cleveland, Detroit, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, and St. Louis, they've all had roughly the same reductions over time of losing a huge number of manufacturing jobs, losing more than 60% of their manufacturing jobs relative to 1969. And folks, a point that the sociologist William Julius Wilson has made is when an area loses manufacturing jobs, this hurts middle-class people. He argued that it really hurt the African-American family, that when manufacturing jobs are lost, the breadwinners, the male breadwinners in these families loses this income. And he argued that the loss of manufacturing jobs is one of the reasons for the rise of female-headed households in several of these cities. And so it has been very costly for these cities to lose their manufacturing base. And in chapter three of the book, Mac and I discuss what are industries that could fill this gap going forward. Of course, manufacturing isn't the only sector of the economy. There's the service sector, retail, wholesale, there's high tech. Relative to the nation as a whole, which is that mustard line, our cities have not had the same overall job growth as the nation as a whole. Philadelphia and Pittsburgh have had a better recent job experience, but all six of our cities have faced this common challenge of not enough local job creation. And perhaps not surprisingly, the poverty rate, the share of people whose income is below the poverty line, is higher across these post-industrial cities than for the nation as a whole. So for the nation as a whole, the poverty rate is roughly 15%. And we see here that in Detroit in the year 2010, that it's over 30%. And we know from the sociology and economics literatures, the challenges young people face, both adults and children, to grow up in poverty. And there's a literature in sociology that if poor children grow up in a community where everyone around them is poor, that that has a negative externality. You're not exposed to people who work, of questions of peer effects in the neighborhood. Not if you don't meet successful people, does that lower your expectations of the benefits of completing education? So there's very important literatures on the negative effects for children of growing up in a high poverty area. And that the net effect is, if you grow up, Raj Chetty of Harvard has argued that when children grow up in disadvantaged neighborhoods, that this has a causal effect on lowering their probability of achieving the American dream, which he measures as moving up in the income distribution when you're an adult. Here, in terms of education, so on the vertical axis is the share of adults in each of our six cities who have graduated from college. The good news here is that across our cities over time, a larger share of the adults are college graduates. But with the exception of Pittsburgh, our cities continue to lag the national average in share of college graduates. And if you see Cleveland and Detroit have much lower shares of adults who are college graduates at roughly 13% in the year 2010 relative to the nation as a whole, which is over 25%. And so this is the human capital gap and an important point because of the economic returns to human capital. Another point, I think I'm going to pass over this in the name of time, but our point here is there's more poverty at the center of the cities than out in the suburbs. That's the negative slope here across all of our cities. Folks, this is an important point. And let me explain, because it's a little bit of a busy graph. What we're graphing here is the fact that there's fewer and fewer homes being built in our cities. So as the population has shrunk, there's no reason for real estate developers to build new housing. So what you see here is for the nation as a whole, that dotted blue line, for the nation as a whole, there's new housing construction. But what we see in our six cities is that real estate developers are building fewer and fewer homes because there isn't population growth, the population's shrinking. And so what this means is the existing housing stock, like Baltimore's row houses, get older each year. And we know about the huge number of vacant housing in Detroit and Baltimore. So you don't have new housing being built, and you have these vacant homes just getting older over time as they depreciate. And that this contributes, this means that lead paint and other urban challenges grow when you have this disinvestment from the housing stock. Now, as an urban economist, something that interests me very much is the supply and demand for real estate. So folks, from Zillow, you can collect data by zip code. And this is a histogram of data from the year 2020. On Zillow, you can collect data, and we see that there's very cheap housing in our six cities. So this cuts both ways. As a market test, this means prices of real estate are equilibrium outcomes from supply and demand. There's two ways to view this histogram. So notice that the average price of a home in the US in 2020 was $260,000, but the average price of a home in Detroit was $43,000, $75,000 in Cleveland, $160,000 in Baltimore. So if you're optimistic about these cities, this could be a great time to purchase real estate. The cliche in asset pricing is to buy low and sell high. If our six cities make a comeback, this would be the right time to purchase real estate in these cities, because right now it's really cheap. And there's a question of why. Are these cities hidden jewels? Or is if you believe in market efficiency, is there a pessimism that the bad times these cities have experienced up till now will continue? So what I want to signal to you here is there is high quality, affordable housing in these cities. So something that has interested me is if you build a faster train between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore, in a work from home economy, there could be great opportunities for people who work in D.C. to live in Baltimore with much more affordable housing in Baltimore than in D.C. So that's a flavor of what Mac and I are discussing in the book. The arbitrage opportunity, the opportunities available in these cities for those who are optimistic about their future of these cities. And what is the objective reality for why there is reason to be optimistic about these cities? And I'll be pivoting to that soon.
You know?
Folks, another key characteristic of our cities is racial segregation of the neighborhoods. And I'd like to spend a minute here because this is an important graph, but it's a complicated graph. So we take the data for our center cities, not for their suburbs, in 1970, in the year 2010. And what census tracts, as you know, are rectangles of 4,000 people. And so a city with 400,000 people would have 1,000 census tracts. It would have 100 census tracts. And what we're doing here is we're asking in the year 1970 for each of these neighborhoods, so census tract equals neighborhood, what share of the neighborhood was African American? And what you see in the year 1970, more than 700 census tracts had very few African Americans. So these were white areas. And we see that there were, in the year 1970, across our six cities, there were roughly 300 neighborhoods which were more than 80% Black. So in 1970, there was a large number of white neighborhoods and there was a large number of Black neighborhoods, but there were fewer Black neighborhoods than white neighborhoods. And folks, notice that there were very few integrated neighborhoods. So take a look at that 40% African-American. In the year 1970, there were only 100 census tracts that were 40% African-American and roughly 60% white, not counting other ethnic groups. In the year 2010, notice the change. There is a sharp shrinkage of white neighborhoods, which I'm defining white neighborhoods as neighborhoods where the African-American share is less than 20%. And troubling, there are still very few residentially integrated neighborhoods. So folks, do you see at the 40th percent, 60%, 80%, do you see that there's very few census tracts there? We have this bimodal distribution. And in the year 2010, there are roughly 600 African-American neighborhoods with very few whites or Asians or Hispanics living there. So our six cities continue to be racially segregated. And I think we need to ask the question, why? And what are the consequences of this racial segregation? Folks, all of our cities face a violent crime issue, and this affects their reputation. When I moved to Johns Hopkins University, other economists said to me, you know, Matt, Baltimore is a dangerous city. If there is a perception that a city has high crime, that will deflect mobile people to the suburbs or to other cities. In 2015, there was the Freddie Gray death, and there was a riot in Baltimore. And given the salience of violent crime, a theme that Mac and I discuss is the importance for the six cities to reduce crime in these cities, but recognizing in the George Floyd aftermath, the crucial issue of what is proper policing, what's the proper role of the police in providing street safety while respecting people's civil rights, and the importance of reducing crime in these cities, both to improve the quality of life of residents of the cities, but also to raise the city's reputation as it competes for people and jobs against other cities like Phoenix, Las Vegas, Boston, of just all the other cities. Because folks, I skipped over that point. One of the big themes of our book is our six cities compete with all of the nation's other cities for jobs and people. Why didn't Amazon HQ2 go to Baltimore? Under what circumstances would it? So that's sort of a theme that goes throughout our book. Folks, a key idea. Folks, could I ask how I'm doing on time? I don't have a watch on me.
We're good, thank you.
I now want to pivot to the future. There are four pillars of success for our six cities to make a comeback. We need new investment in four parts of life. We need for the people of these cities to be investing in their skills. We need the place to be investing in real estate and upgrading the existing infrastructure. We need new incentives and investment for small businesses and entrepreneurship, and government to make investments to raise its game. And our book does a good job talking about how all four pieces of this puzzle fit together. And that's what I'd like to talk about now. Investing in people. Folks, I see two very cute people from Detroit, from the Pasteur Elementary School. My teacher, Jim Heckman, the Nobel laureate, talks about the Heckman equation. Jim Heckman, who we talk about at length in our book, is concerned of how do we help every young person achieve their own full potential. Part of his plan is teaching parents how to be better parents and providing pre-kindergarten, like Bill de Blasio has done in New York for all. And so we talk at length in the book about our cities expanding their investment in young people. In Maryland, there's the Kerwin Commission, and I support that intervention. It is costly. There are public finance questions of how it's going to be paid for. But one of our four pillars for improving quality of life for the people in our cities is this investment in young people. And we can talk more about this in the Q&A. So we talk in the book, there's both questions of how, an example, my colleague Nick Papa George at Johns Hopkins has found when a Black child is taught by at least one Black male teacher, much better outcomes occur for those children. And so there's interesting issues of mentoring, of what can be done in the six cities' public schools to improve the learning environment. In Baltimore, there have been issues that Baltimore's been getting hotter and hotter because of climate change during the school year in May and September. And can air conditioners be installed to improve children's learning in these schools? We talk in the book about different strategies to raise the quality of local education that might be cost effective. Now, we all, including myself, need to continue to be retrained, and that's one of the reasons I was eager to speak to you today. In our ever-changing economy, there is the issue of how do we retrain the workforce for the modern economy? Something that Mac and I have been discussing is how can local community colleges in these cities work on vocational skills that employers are looking for? The role of community colleges in retraining the workforce to help ambitious people acquire the skills they need to find jobs that are attractive to them. And so this interests us very much. of this role of investing in skills for both the young and for adults and middle-aged adults and people my age as well. There, in thinking about strategies for reducing crime in our cities, and thinking about strategies for reducing crime that are respectful of people's civil rights, there is a discussion of ROCA. ROCA is a program that's being brought to Baltimore that's expensive. But what ROCA does is ROCA uses administrative police data to find mostly young men who have committed previous felonies, who are at risk to commit a shooting felony. And without locking these young men up, to identify these young men and to offer job training and cognitive behavioral therapy to help them improve themselves. And ROCA argues that this is an investment strategy that reduces crime in a way that respects civil rights and that helps these young people live, achieve their goals. And so this is an example. So Mac and I discuss in the book that we know that we don't know all the right answers, but when we identify a potentially promising program like ROCA, that we use scientific randomized control trials to pilot this to see if it works, and to also speak to the community about whether they support this program. I think in the post-George Floyd era, it's very important to have community buy-in for strategies meant to improve quality of life. And we talk about this at length in the book. Folks, something that fascinates me and Mac is about the potential of improving entrepreneurship for Black-owned businesses in our six cities. We are very interested in when do small businesses and when do small Black-owned businesses succeed and when do they not succeed. And we are doing interviewing work, and we are studying using administrative data which small businesses have succeeded in Baltimore. And we list the questions here of, we want to know which of these factors are most important in raising the probability that a business succeeds: of access to capital, access to role models, avoiding regulatory red tape. What institutions can the mayor introduce to raise the probability that ambitious people can start a business? And if they're good, win market share. And we give a case study here of a business in Baltimore that is succeeding. We expect that there'll be many more of these. Something that goes on in each of our six cities is each of them has a great university. So in Baltimore is Johns Hopkins, in Pittsburgh is Carnegie Mellon, in Cleveland there's Case Western University, and there's many other great universities. At Hopkins, there is the Johns Hopkins Tech Venture, which is trying to create a Silicon Valley. So Stanford and Berkeley have their Silicon Valley. Hopkins is trying to create this biotech cluster, taking the nerds at the medical school, and as they create their small startup firms, that this creates new skilled jobs in these cities. And this helps poor people in these cities because of rising service demand and of just creating a vibrant ecostructure, creating jobs for more people in these cities. And these are some data on Johns Hopkins' efforts to grow more local companies to create this ecosystem of startups. Another piece of the investment puzzle, and this is related to environmental issues. Old cities have old housing, which raises issues of lead. It raises issues of brownfields. And so in Baltimore, as I mentioned before, there are thousands of old vacant buildings. And in a world where DC has really high home prices, Baltimore could be a very nice place if there was faster transportation between the cities. There could be great opportunities to rebuild Baltimore's housing stock and to remediate blight. And of course, real estate developers will study the risk and return to such investments. The challenge that these cities face is the gentrification challenge. If Baltimore's housing prices start to boom, incumbent homeowners will be rich, but incumbent renters could be priced out of their neighborhoods. A very important issue that Mac and I discuss in our book is how to give renters a stake in prosperity, how to give them a piece of the action so that they benefit from local economic growth. Mac and I argue at length, and I know that several of you have an interest in environmental issues. Folks, take a look at the optimism in the right part here. Child lead poisoning is absolutely terrible. And notice that in all six of our cities, there's been great progress in reducing childhood lead exposure. Mac and I, each of the six cities have great beauty. Baltimore with the Inner Harbor, there's tremendous potential for these cities to lean into their green city advantage. There's great beauty that if these cities can figure out how to turn the vacant land into safe public parks, to revitalize the waterways, to clean up the brownfields, to continue to remove the lead, there's tremendous opportunities to improve quality of life in all six of these cities. And Mac and I discussed this at length. Folks, I'm almost done. Another piece of our optimism is the rise of the big data revolution. Brandon Scott, the new mayor of Baltimore, is very proud, as he should be, that before he was mayor in Baltimore, he made an enormous investment of his time in creating this open data platforms for these city governments to be more honest about their data. And this holds government accountable. When governments provide more data of how they choose who they procure goods from, at what prices they buy goods at, this transparency in government creates good government, and it creates great opportunities to hold government accountable. And Mac and I are very excited about this. Another reason that Mac and I are optimistic about the future for these six cities is successful immigrants in these cities. Now that President Trump is not building walls, we are optimistic that President Biden and Vice President Harris will have more immigrant-friendly policies. In Detroit and in St. Louis and in Baltimore, there are enclaves where immigrants have been quite successful in these cities, and that immigrants represent a new flow of new blood and new ideas bringing diversity to these cities. We also see in the new economy that Facebook is opening some of its campuses in Pittsburgh and Philadelphia. And so the major superstar companies in the US, I believe, will reconsider locating in these cities as they improve their quality of life. So folks, that's actually my last slide. And so let me wrap up with this, because I think I lost a slide there. I'm gonna stop sharing, and I wish I'd had the following. I wish I'd had the following slide. The six cities that we study are a work in progress. And we, in our final chapter of our book, and folks, I'm gonna give you a free copy of my book. In the final chapter of our book, it's titled, in the final chapter of our book, it contrasts history versus expectations. The cities have had a tough 50 years, but Mac and I are convinced through a series of strategic investments by the public and private sector that these cities can raise their game. And this is not a law of physics. And one of the reasons we wrote this book was to start a national discussion on this issue. So folks, my closing statement, think back to that Zillow histogram I showed you of that very cheap real estate. I actually think these cities, that's a good investment opportunity, because I see strategies such that these cities do make a comeback and that home prices start to rise relative to the national average. When you talk, the Goldilocks challenge is for the poor in these cities to have a piece of the prosperity such that they're happy. It would be bad news if a poor resident of Baltimore regrets Baltimore's comeback because she gets priced out of her apartment. In my vision for a better world, she gets a better job that pays better, and the city builds more housing such that her rents do not go way up, and that this is the way for there to be shared prosperity as these cities come back. Folks, I'm eager for let our discussion begin.
Nat, thank you, first of all. Great talk. We appreciate you being here with us. And so, floor's open, good people. Questions? Okay, Lisa, unmute yourself.
Thank you. Thank you so much for today's presentation. I have a question. In your article, you indicated that there were peer cities to the post-industrial, to the six post-industrial cities that you mentioned. How would one find out the peer cities?
So we went back and forth. We had New Orleans in, we had Memphis. We went back and forth on how many cities we could actually include. And what I love about your point is, I'd actually want to hear from Mac. We were not scientific there. I think that I would want to include in the peer cities any cities that have been losing population, losing manufacturing jobs, and where the poverty rate is high. I think I want to stop there because you're going to give me a B minus. That's my short answer.
Okay. Thank you.
And the reason Lisa's question is so important is, right now in America, at least before COVID, there was a tale of two cities, of Seattle and San Francisco and Boston and New York doing so well. Our book really is about the non-superstar cities where millions of people live. And Lisa, is that helpful? And America's superstar cities had a great 20 years, but our six cities are emblematic of challenges facing many people in many cities.
Okay, yes, that was.
And I received a nice email that these issues arise in the United Kingdom, that London has had a great 30 years, but that there's many post-industrial cities in England facing similar issues.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
Thank you, Matt. Other questions? You can either put them in the chat or just raise your hand. Tessa, did you raise your hand? Did I see that correctly? Go ahead.
Yeah, you talked a little bit about improving education, and it sounded like you primarily were discussing K-12 and not as much about adult education and adult basic education. Right now in the US, about 90% of people who need adult basic education and remediation are not participating in programs. Programs are underfunded. And research shows that family education improves the life of children. So I wondered if you had really looked at adult education as it pertains to improving cities.
So this is a great question. And you're right that we may have underemphasized this important issue. Where we do discuss this issue is when we discuss vocational training. Tessa, tell me more. Are you focused on the GED? Where we felt we were talking about adult education was vocational training. We didn't do a great job on the GED.
Well, the GED has some problems, and I could have a long discussion with that. I'm an adult basic educator. I specialize in numeracy. And as California and other places know, remediation with numeracy is one of the biggest problems in getting people to complete post-secondary school. And there's a real issue with that. And so I'm talking about not just vocational education, but numeracy and literacy as a collective. And so that's really where I'm coming from. I'm in the process of starting to apply for PhD programs. And that's really where my focus of research would be, because the little research that's out there about numeracy shows that actually right now there are more adults with low numeracy skills, and it is more predictive of health outcomes, wealth outcomes, even incarceration.
I think you're raising a key point. And the Nobel laureate Gary Becker would agree with you let me give an example that supports your point. Doug Bernheim of Stanford University ran an experiment related to numeracy. He, in a randomized treatment control design, he educated adults about financial literacy, of teaching folks about compound interest rates, teaching people about stocks versus bonds. And he documented that these men and women who were randomly assigned to the treatment group were more sophisticated investors afterwards. And that directly supports what you said. What I really like about your point is you made a positive externality point. What I heard you say is if Matthew has three daughters, and if Matthew becomes numerate because of an adult education intervention, there's a spillover effect that I teach my children how to these skills, and that there's sort of a multiplier effect here. And I like that very much. I think that that's a very promising research line that we don't do a great job in the book. I think we hinted it, but in the name of writing a short book, we glossed over your important point.
That's the next book, Matt.
But I think Tessa should write that book. I think, and I respect her her optimism there that to say something. An awkward point when I was at the University of Chicago was, can you teach old dogs new tricks? And I want to believe the answer is yes, but as I age, at least for me, I'm worried the answer is no, but I want to believe we live in a world where we're always malleable and we can always improve. I like very much Tessa's optimism that middle-aged people like me, if I'm lacking in certain key skills, that we can remediate that. And I want to live in that world.
I work in that world. So now I want to prove that it works.
Okay. Looking forward
I think that's very meaningful. Hey, can I jump into Eric's question?
I was just going to read it out loud so everybody sees it too. Eric is on his phone, so he has a tough time unmuting himself. But his question is, what can be done to overturn coordination failure? The idea that independent but interconnected decision makers underinvest and move too slowly to reverse historical trends.
You guys are very good. All the questions have been great. So folks, there was that old Catch-22 movie of getting coordination failure to an economist is a fancy word for a Catch-22. Let me tell a bad story that I don't like. Suppose there's a real estate developer. So which way do I want to do this? I see how I want to do this. Folks, suppose that Matthew is a 16-year-old in Baltimore, and I need to make a decision whether I pay attention in high school or not. If I don't think that there's a job there, if I don't think there's jobs when I finish high school, I'm going to be less likely to finish high school and to pay attention. But if there are employers thinking of moving to Baltimore and they say the workforce isn't work ready, we're not moving to Baltimore. So folks, do you see that ugly catch-22? That's the coordination failure. So to say that again, if young people aren't studying in school because they don't think there's jobs, and if jobs are not moving to Baltimore because they don't think there's a workforce ready workforce, that's actually an ugly equilibrium. How do we break out of that coordination failure? What Mac and I discussed there is a couple of different pathways. If Johns Hopkins has this success with its startup incubator, and if a Baltimore or Philadelphia, I'm sorry, Pittsburgh with robotics, Pittsburgh's becoming a center of robotics. If Baltimore became a center of biotech, of this creating this nascent hub and creating a booming local service economy, this would create more local jobs. Another way, Eric, to solve the coordination failure is if there could be a large reduction in crime in these cities. There's a large number of new urbanists, including my parents. So my parents visited me in the Harbor East, and my parents had not been in Baltimore for 50 years. And my mother turned to me and said, Matthew, this is just like San Francisco. And the mayor of Baltimore would have loved to have heard my mother being effusive about Baltimore. And so one way out of the coordination failure is to an expansion of the ROCA program to reduce the violent crime rate in these cities, because there's many young progressive and progressive people of all ages who want to live in cities and would do so if they feel the quality of life is higher. And so Mac and I point to quality of life progress as perhaps the most promising thread for beginning to break out of this coordination failure.
Connika first, and then Tracy, and then Gail.
Yeah, my question was literally the last word of what you said. Could you say more about the ROCA program, the strategy, and how it's worked in Baltimore, and what are the measures that you've seen or the factors of why it's effective in violence reduction?
So this is an absolutely crucial question. And in my first year in Baltimore, I have not been able to connect with the program leaders. So let's walk through this, because this question is a first order. And unfortunately, I don't know the answers to her excellent questions, but let's talk this through. I think that an excellent dissertation could be written here. Folks, again, ROCA, there's at least three components to ROCA. Folks, ROCA does not involve the police. So it involves the police in the first stage. The police have to open up their administrative records. Guys, let me make a couple of statistical points. Baltimore has 600,000 residents. Suppose that there are 1,000 young men, and folks, I apologize to the women, but let's focus on young men as being prone to violence. If that's controversial, we could come back to that. Let there be 1,000 young men in Baltimore who perhaps they're in gangs. The first step to ROCA is to identify young people at risk to pick up a gun, to point it at someone, and to pull the trigger. And perhaps these could have been gang members. Perhaps these individuals, as juveniles, have an arrest record. The first step in ROCA is to use information at the individual level to identify potentially violent individuals. And folks, to respect their civil rights, because they have not committed, they are innocent. ROCA is about early intervention. There was that Tom Cruise movie Minority Report, which I never saw, but if do folks still like Tom Cruise? Fair enough. My son liked him in Mission Impossible. And with ROCA, once these young men are identified, the goal of ROCA is to entice them to show up for training. Folks, that raises a second issue. Should we pay these young men to show up for ROCA? So think at your university. If there's a blood drive, do you just say, folks, we're looking for people to volunteer to give blood? So do you pay to attract people to come in to give blood? Or do you just say, we're looking for volunteers to give blood? So a second step to ROCA will be more likely to succeed if more of these young individuals at risk actually accept the invitation to enroll in the program. And folks, another question is the following. If ROCA expands its program and tries to train hundreds of these young men, does the average quality of the program decline? So a key issue with ROCA is you need very skilled people to train these young men to change their lives. And there's a question of how ROCA trains their people to do the training. Does that make any sense? And I'm slightly concerned that this is a difficult skill. Folks, does anyone have any psychological training? I'm actually not qualified to speak to that.
We have some folks, some social work as well. We have some social workers among us as well. Yeah.
Connika, can I ask you to jump in? I didn't mean to speak
so
long.
I was following your 3 points. I mean, I'm in DC, of course, and so, I mean, I'm familiar with some policing things, and I've heard strategies like this, but it just jumped out at me. But I was with your second point. I think when you even got to the part where you talked about skilled practitioners, there are quite a few programs that use people that deploy people who've had some involvement in the criminal justice system who come back and who are now trainers and work in programs like this. So that does make sense. This couldn't happen. And I also have a background in workforce development where there is much data to show that paying people does actually lead to better participation. That can be debatable, but all of that is making sense. But your third point, because I was curious what the elements were, but no, was that the third one? But
yes.
It does make sense. Okay. The skilled practitioners. Yeah, no, that makes sense. I was just curious what it was. So this is a program level thing that's deployed working with community, some kind of community program that has access to police data and they have the agreement. And
that's the awkward point, because these young men also have the right to privacy. And it will interest me if any of them sue saying, why am I getting this letter hinting that I could be a violent person? Kanika, I want to pick up on your point. I'm an economist, and as an economist, I believe that superstars should be paid superstar pay. So ROCA is not a for-profit. ROCA is a nonprofit. And here's my question. Suppose that you work for ROCA, and you prove yourself to be a superstar in helping young men change their lives. As a University of Chicago economist, I would pay you $300,000 a year for that as a superstar in this field. It would interest me whether ROCA gives financial incentives to its best social workers.
Well, let's talk about that $300,000 afterwards. Thank you. And thank you for the free book, but thank you. Yes, there is data on that.
Okay, wait, one after the other. Tracy had her hand up first and then Gail. Okay, Tracy, you're on.
Okay. Thank you so much for that, Matthew. I have a point and then a question. You mentioned your parents coming to Harbor East. I've spent a lot of time in Baltimore over the years, living here 13 years, and it's definitely a tale of two cities. Everything that is tourist facing, everything that's downtown has been very, very quick to be developed. But, you know, aside from Kevin Plank and doing some things in Cherry Hill and some of those things, some of the other areas that are less popular and are further away from the water that are not necessarily something that can attract tourists or attract large dollars have become, definitely undeveloped in Baltimore. Harbor East just sprang out of nowhere seemingly, and the rest of Baltimore is starkly undeveloped in contrast. And my question to you is, you've mentioned a lot about Johns Hopkins and the things that they're doing. And as a world-renowned university, what is their obligation to Baltimore? They're in this city. They are, flourishing all of these ideas, all of this money. What do you think their responsibility is as a resident of Baltimore?
So I know this is a very important question. And I know that the president, Ron Daniels, wrestles with this on two levels. Let's talk this through. This is very important. First of all, the new mayor of Baltimore, Brandon Scott, is going to have a very interesting discussion with Ron Daniels about what property taxes Hopkins should pay. Because folks, major nonprofits like Hopkins do not pay property taxes. And the mayor, I had the opportunity to meet the mayor, and he actually mentioned this subject to me during my meeting with him, that he was eager to speak to President Daniels about what is Hopkins' responsibility to the city. And I would say this, Tracy, I teach roughly 100 undergraduates at Hopkins each year in a couple of classes. And with the exception of people going to the medical school, none of them plan to live their lives in Baltimore. They're all getting ready to head to New York or San Francisco. And when I push them on why, it can sometimes get a little bit awkward as people clam up. And I am a believer in open discussions. And one way that Hopkins can be a better citizen in Baltimore is to introduce its students to more of the city. I'll give one example. We had a really nice dinner. Linda Laubert is a professor at Morgan State, and she brought 15 of her students over to Hopkins, and we had a dinner party for 25 of us. And the young people were angry that I didn't serve booze at the event. But we had a very nice event, the 25 of us. And one of the waiters at the Hopkins Faculty Club told me that he went to Morgan State and he had never seen students from Morgan State at the Hopkins Faculty Club. And so, this is not a great example, but this is one example of my introducing my students to people from the rest of Baltimore. And we had a really good dinner. I think that Hopkins students have been in a little bit of a bubble and seeing the harbor, the touristy parts of the harbor that you alluded to, but not really seeing Baltimore as a whole. Now let's go back to President Daniels. He made a major investment in the Middle East neighborhoods around the medical school, and there were concerns that he was clearing out poor people in the name of boosting the medical school. And the Baltimore Brew and other newspapers have had long profiles on this. Where I think you're absolutely right is, and this comes back to shared prosperity, for successful economic actors in our six cities, what are their social responsibilities? President Daniels has created scholarships for young people in Baltimore. So Teresa, can I ask you, if President Daniels were here, are there specific proposals you would make to him? Because he's wrestling with this issue of how to make the people of Baltimore be proud of Johns Hopkins and not suspicious of the intentions of the institution.
From my perspective, first of all, I think that I would start with the high schools. And if there is some type of biotech or some type of program that Hopkins is having, have a pipeline straight from the high schools to go to Hopkins or to be involved in their programs, some type of vocation or science education that would lead the students in the Baltimore education system to Hopkins or to other schools that give them an education and an opportunity, because scholarships are great, but what is a scholarship gonna do to that kid that's barely getting out of high school, who is concerned if his lights are gonna get cut off tomorrow? That doesn't help him or her for that matter. You know, there are some kids that are just on the edge of survival, and while college scholarships are great, they need money and they need opportunities to earn money for themselves, and not only for themselves, but sometimes for their families. So college is not necessarily an option for everyone, but I do believe that vocational training and skill-based training is very underutilized. There are lots of industries now that don't have enough people to work in them. So I think that there are opportunities to train for different types of careers that aren't necessarily college oriented that can give people a way to support themselves and their families.
I think those are excellent points. Tracy, you reminded me of President Daniels created Hopkins Buy Local. And what Hopkins is now doing, Hopkins controls hundreds of millions of dollars of procurement contracts. And he ordered the units on campus to give special preferential treatment to local suppliers. And so this is sort of a Keynesian push to purchase local. Trisha, I wanted to tell you about a project of mine that failed. We ran into data limitations, but I thought it was a smart project. Hopkins hires many local people to work at Hopkins. And what I wanted to study is, if Tracy and Matt are neighbors, and if Hopkins hires Tracy, does Matt subsequently apply for a job at Hopkins, as I learned that there's good jobs at Hopkins? And so I wanted us to write a paper on job referrals, but the university blocked me, saying I was asking for sensitive data.
I understand that, and that's great, but I mean, a lot of the community people that do work at Hopkins are in low-skill jobs, correct?
Yes.
There are dietitians, there are nurses' aides, there, yes, you know, there are janitors, right? They aren't necessarily in a job that necessarily has a positive upward trajectory. And while that's great for income right now, what does that do for their future growth and prosperity? Because if I'm a janitor, if I am, you know, a orderly or anything of that nature, you know, how can I move beyond that if we're talking about a shared prosperity? And yes, I do have a job, but how is that going to send my family in a positive trajectory, or where can I go from there in a sense?
That's very fair. And it comes back to Tessa's point of whether Hopkins has thought about lifelong learning and other programs for these individuals, or do they not have enough time in their day to do that? I take your point. If President Daniels were here, he might say, and I do not speak for him, we offer good benefits in terms of health insurance, and this guarantees that our workers' children are have the beginnings of a foundation to achieve their goals. But I take your point.
Right, because it's been proven that there's not very many places in this country that you can survive on minimum wage.
So I'm gonna change gears a little bit. I'm gonna take both Gail, Gail is next, and Tanya. So we get both of your questions in, okay? Gail, you're next, and then Tanya. I'll have you respond to both of them, Matt. Is that okay? All right.
Thank you for a provocative presentation. There's so much, you know, with all the graphs, it's like, where do you even start to respond? I do wanna mention that I actually got my master's degree at Hopkins in the DC program in economics. And so yeah, I'm familiar with the structure of the university. But a couple of things struck me, and I just wanna, and I'm not gonna be long, but the ROCA project, when you described it, you described it as expensive. And the one thing I think about it, and I know we've already talked about it with Konica's question, but is that there's an assumption to bring in ROCA, there's an assumption that there is a population that the educational system is going to fail. It's an assumption. And so my thought is, why not begin to patch those holes or address those holes? I bet we could bring to the table 10, you know, or any number of educators that already know who these young men are that you're going to try to catch some years later. And that if they had some different exposure, opportunities, or whatever, you know, earlier on, and not to say that later on that there doesn't need to be some intervention, but I think it becomes backwards. It's kind of like, you know, there's an expectation that they're going to fail, and then it becomes an experiment, you know, like a project. Let's try to help after the fact, when it could be done proactively. And you mentioned in your comment with Tracy about the suspicion of Johns Hopkins, you know, the suspicion toward Hopkins, but I would suggest that it's probably the two sides of the same coin, the violence and the suspicion, you know? And so if you really begin to get to the root of cause of what the violence, what spurns that, you know, what, and then what is the underlying, why those suspicions? I mean, if I grew up in Baltimore for generations and then this guy just moves in yesterday and he's, you know, got all of this and I'm over here struggling or, you know, trying to figure my way out, there's going to be that tension. And there's lots of resources that just could be channeled in different ways to facilitate a real solution. And I should have started with this, which is that we're doing some research on economic diversity. And so the question is, in your research, you mentioned Black businesses or, you know, entrepreneurship and kind of focusing on that, but on a broader scale, as far as diversifying the economy, because, you know, Baltimore, again, you're talking about post-industrial cities and post-industrial economies, but how do you diversify or what are ways that you're seeing diversifying that? Because we know more diverse economies and not just about who's owning the business, you know, not like ethnic diversity, but the different industries that are making up the economy are more robust and they actually tend to be more sustainable. So if you could speak to that.
Okay, Tanya.
Okay, so I have two questions that actually touch on what my last colleagues have talked about. On the CBT programs that ROCA does, I've actually looked at or read some stuff and some things on NPR where they started in the high schools. And so if you've got any information about how they're using CBT programs in the high schools, and I think that speaks to Gail's point in terms of catching people even earlier. The other question that I had was your thoughts. You mentioned about making sure that those who are local, that, you know, maybe poor now, are not pushed out of the creation of Baltimore. And so other thoughts that you have about how to develop, say, wealth in terms of home ownership with the residents that are currently there that are Baltimoreans, as well as things that potentially Johns Hopkins could do in terms of, if they're looking at biotech incubators, there may be also, you know, if they've got a robust employment of service industry, instead of that being employment, maybe they can partner, or maybe they can do something to actually develop, say, employee-owned small businesses, or develop businesses in those service industries where people also have a piece of the ownership and can create wealth in that way. So those were my two questions. Your thoughts on those?
These are great. A few thoughts, but I love what you guys are saying. Let me start with Gail. Gail makes an important point that I'm wondering if we glossed over this in the book. We need a second edition. So Jane Jacobs was a famous urban planner who celebrated that the greatness of New York City was its diverse ecosystem of firms, that learning takes place. So Gail was making at least two points. So she was well trained by Johns Hopkins, and I was not her teacher. She doesn't need me.
I take some claim for that.
Very good. So Jane Jacobs celebrated economic diversity, where her definition was learning, that a bra manufacturer can learn from a glue manufacturer, if that makes any sense. And that in a face-to-face economy, that the density of New York City created this learning and serendipity and learning in cities that would not occur in a one-horse town like Pittsburgh with steel. And so Gail is, and another benefit of a diverse economy is financial diversification. If you have many different types of firms in a city, you're robust. If the boss of some firm has a heart attack, that doesn't drag down the whole economy. You haven't put all your eggs in one basket. And so there's something very promising to a diverse ecosystem within a city. Gail also made an important point where she talked about each of our six cities' educational system, that teachers have private information about which of their students are gifted and which students are going to be a handful in the future. And a very interesting issue that Mac and I have not discussed is, do teachers have a way that is safe for them and that respects the students' rights for them to announce to the city, here are the kids at risk in the near term? Would that lead to lawsuits? Or does a teacher have the right incentives to highlight which students are at risk? And I think that that's very important from economics. We know that there's private information, there's comparative advantage. Teachers have a unique ability to know which students are at risk who could greatly benefit from specific programs. It would interest me if the public teachers can reveal these names, or in this age of privacy, would there be a lawsuit? On Tanya's excellent points, the city of Chicago, President Obama was a supporter of the Be a Man program. And as I understand Be a Man, this is a program that teaches, I think I could benefit from this training. People know that I can get very angry and that I can do some very stupid things, usually that makes an ass of myself when I get angry. And the Be a Man program, as I understand it, is basically to count to 10 and to make decisions when you're in a cool state of mind and you're not in a hot emotional state. And so my understanding as an economist, not as a psychologist, is self-awareness and self-control, almost like being a Jedi in Star Wars, and that it is believed that this skill can be taught. There have been rigorous evaluations of these programs. Some economists have been concerned that the benefits of these programs fade out over time. I hope that's not true, but a prominent Harvard economist said that to me, that that's his concern with CBT, but I hope that that's false. Tanya also asked the crucial question about how do we give the poor in these cities a piece of the prosperity? And Mac wrote a couple of pages in our book, and you're going to get a free copy of the book, where we talk about land trusts. In a land trust, land would be set aside, publicly owned land. Basically, shares of that land would be given to incumbent residents of the city. And as the city gets more prosperous and as Zillow home prices rise, these individuals would get a check. So folks, in Alaska, the residents of Alaska get a check from the government because of the oil reserves. There'd be something analogous to that if there was this land bank. So to say that again, there is plenty of vacant land in our six cities that the city owns when these cities unlock their full potential and rise, that those land values will rise and that can correspond to a check. Tanya, one more point. Something that puzzles me is why are rental contracts for apartments only one-year contracts? If we could allow residents to sign longer contracts, they could lock in their current rents and face less gentrification risk. So in my fantasy about our cities, the comeback of these cities would lead to greater economic prosperity without rent soaring. And one way to achieve that win-win is to allow real estate developers to build more housing in these cities such that you have an upward sloping supply curve of housing, not a vertical supply curve. But these are all excellent questions. And one thing that I hope that's come out of my discussion is I do not know all of these answers. What we emphasize in the book is a culture of experimentation, that we're not satisfied with the current equilibrium in these cities and the importance of trying out new ideas and seeing if they succeed or not, and when a good idea succeeds, scale it up. Because Sabine, have you spoken to your students about Esther Duflo and her Nobel Prize in Economics 2 years ago?
Have not yet, no. Some of you who've taken ecological economics, but no, not the whole group, yeah.
So Esther Duflo of MIT, and let me put her name in the chat room. She's a much more important economist than me. I was with her in India. She is an absolutely, she won the Nobel Prize at age 47. So at age 55, I have not won the Nobel Prize. So Esther Duflo is the world's leading development economist in running field experiments in the developing world. In parts of the developing world where there is poverty, where people are not achieving their full potential, she is trying randomized interventions. I'll give an example. She did the following in India. She installed a camera in a random set of Indian classrooms such that teachers would know that it would be recorded in a database if they didn't teach for certain hours. And this led teachers to show up and actually teach when they knew they were being monitored by the camera. So isn't that kind of funny? And so this was about a randomized experiment of how you incentivize teachers in India, not the state of Indiana, in the nation of India, how do you incentivize rural teachers to do their job? And that's an example of what she does. She thinks about what is an underperforming part of the economy and what is a relatively cheap intervention that could improve quality of life. And in our book, we throw out a huge number of ideas that try to approximate Esther Duflo's vision for what could be cost-effective strategies for improving urban quality of life.
Yeah. And that, of course, reminds me also of the first woman who received the Nobel Prize in economics, namely
Eleanor Ostrom.
And when you mentioned the land trusts, right, and Eleanor's work on the commons and the public good, I think is also very relevant to these re-envisioning cities and what could potentially help in their uplift, because sometimes it's not individual ownership, but it's collective ownership that does the trick, especially when you have to pool skills, right?
Okay, do we have time? Still have 10 more minutes?
We've got 10 minutes, exactly, yes.
So there is a prominent cancer scholar at Hopkins named Otis Brawley. And I want to tell you a story that he told me. He said to me, Matt, I'm trying to convince more young people in more young African Americans to not start smoking. And I said to him, I said, Otis, have you told these young people what is their risk of dying from lung cancer in their 50s? And he said to me, Matt, for many of the people I've met, they expect to die in gun violence, and thus these lung cancer things don't matter to them. And that's an example of the coordination failure, that if there was greater safety, if there was less stress in their lives, then he would have more success with his public health campaigns of what are the risks in a competing risk model. If you think you're going to face violence, then it doesn't really matter that you also face lung cancer risk because you didn't expect to live long enough to reach that point. And so that was a sobering discussion I had with him that that never occurred to me. And I learned from him from that discussion. And that's some of the mindset. Eric asked another question. Dr. Khan, you also discuss in the book investments in human capital in efforts to grow the urban pie. Does growing the urban pie equate to improving urban quality of life? A question that I've wrestled with is, what is the good life? We all know that as you think about your own conception of the good life, I have the feeling that you're like me, that it's not just about how much money you have in your wallet. I did not go to Wall Street. My father hoped that I'd go to medical school, but I got a C in chemistry, and that was the end of that. I do believe that a Baltimore, and for our other five cities, a city with great, let me set it up like this. The two are interconnected. Of the earnings of the city and quality of life, there's sort of a chicken and egg issue. If Brandon Scott can have a successful biotech cluster in Baltimore, he will have a larger tax base. With a larger tax base, he can tax that golden goose and have more money to spend on improved public goods, on improved public transit, improved public education, improved garbage pickup. And so I think that there's a tight synergy between a booming local economy and the mayor having the financial base to provide the services that the people deserve. And to flip that around, if a city doesn't have garbage pickup, if the streets are full of potholes, if the streets are unsafe, then the tax base is gonna leave. And so there is this sort of chicken and egg there. And that's my short answer. But this has been very good for me. And I've learned a couple of things here from our talk, from all the questions. I've got a bunch of notes from my co-author I want to bug him about.
Okay, great. And do we have one last question or are we good? One more?
I have a comment. I see you have a lot of questions. Go to Anna because she hasn't asked anything.
Okay, Anna, you are next. See if you can, if we can make your microphone work. Can't hear you, Anna. Can you put it in the chat? Okay, put it in the chat. And Tanya, while we're waiting for Anna to put her question in the chat, back to you.
Yeah, actually mine is maybe just a thought on the ROCA or the CBT. One of the things you mentioned was your concern that say ROCA would be diluted when if they try to reach a lot of people. And so maybe one area that, you know, one of these folks could research would be sort of like an each one teach one type of program and how that really works and if that could work in this instance. Does that really dilute? And if you actually move it into the high school levels, you know, can you get high schoolers to kind of say, hey, take a minute, take 10 breaths and, you know, think before.
That is brilliant. And Tanya, you just picked up on one of Esther DeFlo's key ideas. So you are a future Nobel laureate. So what Esther DeFlo has asked is the following question. When a pilot program succeeds, and when we get excited about that, can we naively extrapolate that if you scale up that program, that it will continue to succeed at the same rate? Or some economists have worried of a Hawthorne effect, that people do-gooders are aware that if the program succeeds, the Gates Foundation will invest billions in it, and they try their best with the pilot round, and then everything goes to crap as you try to scale it up. But you asked just the right point. You made a great point with your one-to-one buddy approach. That might be more likely to have constant returns to scale and the potential to be able to scale it up.
Yes, I think that that's slower. It's slower, but you know, it could be.
Because to repeat myself, this is a major theme in Esther DeFlo's work. When we have a great pilot and we are jumping up and down and talking to the New York Times that we have found something great, when it is ugly if when it scales up, when we scale it up, if the average treatment effect declines because there is because of diminishing returns, if that makes any sense.
I was going to say with that too, that the community component part of it is also, you know, that success is created in the community. And when it's over, then it's like, you know, you just go back to the traumas that you just, you know, were kind of coming through healing on. And I also wanted to mention that growing up in DC during the days where DC stood for Dodge City, because it was like the murder rate was the highest. I mean, a lot of us, and I know I had that feeling, didn't feel like we were going to live very long. I mean, that was just a part of, and I would venture to say that in a lot of African-American communities in particular, you know, there's that, you know, constant thing. I mean, you know, even probably some people on this panel could, you know, driving in certain areas or whatever, like, you know, that's a part of the stressor that's there. So
last question and comment, and Matt, it's absolutely clear to me that we have to have you back sometime, okay? So, but here is Anna's question from Mexico City. Anna said, on slide number 13, you mentioned segregated neighborhoods in the six cities. Do you think there's a correlation between gentrification and white flight? Any thoughts?
That's Eric's question, and Anna's is the one above that.
Sorry.
So Anna posed, what can government do to encourage startups? So one thing that my co-author, and I should have said this, so Anna, thank you. It is our impression that there are some terrific Black business people who, if they could access collateral, could start up an impressive business, but face collateral constraints that they don't have the savings, that some banks may be slow to make loans to them because of a lack of collateral. I think that something that government can do in this case is to co-sign loans and to think about what are ways to reduce these financing constraints such that businesses can launch. There's ways to form portfolios of these loans to reduce risk exposure. So my short answer there is I want to see government playing a role helping the private sector screen loans and to give small businesses a fighting chance to launch, especially post-COVID.
All right. This is all the time we have, unfortunately. I know we could go.
Thank you, folks.
Matt, thank you so much for joining us for this seminar today. And I meant it when I said we will have to have you back. And thank you so much also for the offer of books for the students.
I'm going to email it to you right after class as a PDF.
I know I'm going to have a lot of takers on that. Thank you so much. Thank you all for joining us for this Causes Research Seminar. I'll see you next month. Thank you. Bye-bye.